big primary, the big primary goal as a manager is pushing out the work. Secondarily, live it in the budget. Maybe secondarily, staff oversight, which is a nice way of making sure there's no screw-ups. Okay? Nowhere, it may be different, is talent development a primary responsibility of managers. So I'm going to suggest, as one of the success metrics, have we transformed the role in the next 5 years of managers in this organization, where in addition to pushing out the work, developing talent is a primary, not a secondary, not a discretionary role. If it becomes a primary role, you'll be successful. If it remains a discretionary, nice to do, maybe I'll get to it, you will fail. I believe that the primary role of leaders is to grow more leaders. So we're going to talk about some of the skills you need to do that. Let's take a 10-minute break, come back, and then we'll do some work after our break. Okay. Now, I want to pivot and now focus directly on this topic of succession development and what can we learn from other organizations in the public sector that have effectively developed succession development programs. So, first of all, there are some classic goals of succession development, talent development initiatives. The first one is to create a leaderful organization. That's a wonderful phrase from Margaret Wheatley, that you don't want to just develop leaders at the top. You will fail dealing with these very big challenges if you're just developing leaders at the top. You want to develop leaders at all levels of the organization. And if you do, you will create a leaderful organization. And again, anybody can be a leader. It's who is exerting positive influence to address the big issues of the day. The second goal is, of course, what we've been talking about, which is ensuring the organization has the competencies and the capacities needed to meet the big challenge. If you're training people to deal with technical issues, and the big adaptive challenges are all non-technical in nature, which they are, you will fail. So how do we ensure that we have the competencies and capacities in place to meet the big challenges? And number three is a very important one. You are not doing position replacement. Let me say that again. You are not doing position replacement. If the finance director is retiring, the focus is not who becomes the finance director. That's not the focus. The focus is creating a pool of talent ready and able to move into any position, any important position, when it becomes available. So it's a pool of talent. And it is very important that you understand that talent does not belong to the department. The talent does not belong. Some departments try to hoard their talent, which is very understandable. But we want talent, a pool of talent, to be ready and able to move into whatever position becomes available. Now, there are certain positions where you commit to a career. Police, let's just take, you commit to moving up in the police, law enforcement, and it is unusual for that person to move into a non-law enforcement position. I understand that. But generally speaking, you're creating a pool of talent throughout the organization. Now, there's a private sector metric that you should be aware of. The great talent machines, like General Electric, as an example. Their metric for success is having three, not one, not two, three candidates who are ready and able to step into any important position at any time. Think of the last time you did an important recruitment. Did you have three ready and able candidates to move into that position? No. I don't know anything about you, but I can say no. That's the message. Okay, so those are sort of the classic goals. Now, as we look at this issue, yes, you have to make sure you have the technical skills. You have a water quality plant, you better have somebody with a class 3 certificate, whatever it is, class 4, whatever. Otherwise, you can't operate the facility. Okay? If you're in police, you better have people who know how the technical aspects of how you do the job. You're a paramedic, you're a utility worker. Okay. But I want to emphasize, it's not an or, it's an and. Technical and non-technical school. Here's a study done by the Harvard Business School, and they looked at the skills needed at different levels of management. At lower management, you need a chunk of technical skills. That's a technical concept. A chunk of technical skills, some people skills, and a sliver of analytical skills. Mid-management, you need all three. Top management, you need a chunk of analytical skills, some people skills, and a sliver at best, of technical skills. Now, you get, what's the common skill set? People skills at all levels of management. You get promoted into lower level management because of your technical skills. You fail in management because of poor people skills. In this study, not 50, not 60, not 70, 80% of management failure was related to poor people skills. Had nothing to do with technical or analytical skills. So, as you look at your menu of development experiences that you're offering people so they can accelerate your development, are we emphasizing the soft skills as well as the hard skills? As you rise in management, the soft skills determine the hard results. The soft skills determine the hard results. Okay, now we're going to collect some data from you. So what I want you to do is take out a pen. What we want to do is create all kinds of very powerful development experiences so that we accelerate the development of people. So I want you to think about your career, your life, really. And I want you to identify one very powerful, or in fact the most powerful, development experience you've ever had that really accelerated your development, a powerful development experience. I want you to write down what that specific experience was, jot it down. And then most importantly, number two, what were the key ingredients making it such a robust learning and development experience? What was the nature of the experience? What were the key ingredients that made it such a great development experience? So let's do that now. Everybody's had a powerful development experience, or you wouldn't be in this room. So let's do that. Take out a pen. What was the experience, and what were the key ingredients? Okay. Can you stand, please?
Well, I have to say it's from quite a while ago, but I did my...
Can you stand, please? Thank you. Tell us your name.
Sue Graziano.
Okay. What was the powerful development experience?
It's three of them.
No, big one.
No.
Yes. I think nobody ever stands up to it.
Sorry. Learning to ride a bike, swim, and read.
Which, okay, you're going to combine those?
Yes.
Okay. So, swim, read, and ride a bike.
Right.
Okay. Very powerful development experience.
Lifetime.
Okay. What, in analyzing those situations, those learning experiences, what was a key ingredient?
Practice and mentorship.
Practice. And then mentorship, somebody showed you how and coached you how to do it.
Kept me from drowning.
Okay, so practice and mentoring and failure. You fell off the bike.
Oh, yes.
Okay, so mistakes.
Yeah.
And learning from the mistakes were key. Let's put that down. Failure, learning from the mistakes. Okay, what else was a key ingredient? How important was it to you?
Very.
Ah, so it was imbued with purpose and meaning for you.
Very motivational, yes.
Yes, because it was important to you and your development. Was it difficult?
Yes.
Okay, so there was, it was difficult. It wasn't easy. You didn't get on the bike and start pedaling.
No.
Okay, so it was difficult. And you stretched. Okay, so let's put stretching. Anything else you'd like to tell us about?
No.
Those are the key. Okay, very good. Who has another powerful development experience? Yes, Janice, can you stand, please? What was the experience?
Mine was very simple. It was just a conversation.
You just got one. I mean, I gave her three, but she looks like a powerful person.
So it was just a conversation that I had, and it was with Aaron Becker from Public Works. And I was sort of struggling with, you know, wanting to be a leader.
Right.
And so he just said to me, why are you waiting for permission from someone above you to be a leader? You already are one, just be one. And so that for me was just a switch that flipped.
Okay, so the feedback.
It was the conversation and it was somebody.
Conversation, let's put this down, conversation.
I think it was that he.
And by the way, again, great things happen in conversation. Okay, and then the other thing you were gonna say, I'm sorry.
Believing in me.
And mom, this is key. Believing in me. You would not have made this big jump if this other person didn't believe in you. And the reason he was willing to take the time to have this conversation was he, I believe, cared for you.
Correct.
Let's put that down. Somebody cared for me. By the way, all the research shows that caring for me is very powerful. Very, if somebody understands, you care about them. You believe in them. You see the, let's add this, you see the potential in them. He saw the potential in you to be a great leader. Right. He just had to encourage you. Wow, thank you. Let's take another one. Yes, sir, can you stand? Please stand. Okay, what was the experience? What's your name, I'm sorry.
Hang on, City of Santa Cruz.
No, this time.
Yeah.
Great.
I wanted to help him out. I care about him. I believe in him. I see his potential. Great. Okay. Got to have a little fun doing this, man.
I have no humor, so let's cut it off a little bit.
Okay. So, Greg, what was your powerful development experience?
I had a boss told me once to never be clandestine.
Never be clandestine.
Share as much knowledge as you have and share it with as many people as possible all the time, then you will likely never have anyone try to replace you.
Okay,
your
so
goal is to make them replace you.
Lesson. Somebody share some lessons. Okay, now, why was that such a powerful thing for you that years later you bring it up? Why was it powerful?
Because I've been through a lot of experiences where there were people at jobs that clutched their knowledge with an iron fist, and they would never let it out because they were so insecure of someone else coming along and taking their job.
So it led you to be self-critical about yourself and others.
Yep.
So you became a lot more sensitive and critical about other people, yourself, the environment, and therefore you could learn.
Well, positivity critical.
Yeah, critical in a positive way. Critical in a positive way. And what was this relationship with the boss? Now, go ahead. What was the relationship?
Well, he loved me, of course.
He loved you. Not just cared for him, he loved him. So cared for me, loved me. By the way, I know we don't talk about love in the work environment, but love is a very powerful force.
Oh, God.
Okay, that is my point. Okay, I want to add one. I want to add one, which is autonomy. How many people had a powerful development experience where you were given autonomy to figure it out? Autonomy is really a critical, all the research shows. So, here we go. Yes. Would you like to share with us your list?
My personal list?
No.
Is
there something that in your experience that was not included? How about resources?
Risk-taking,
which is part, thank you, let's write that down. Okay. Risk-taking, part of this autonomy thing is you're allowed to take risks, and fall off the bike and get up and learn. Okay, any other one that you want to put down? Okay, so why don't you quickly go over our list?
Practice, mentoring, failure, learning from mistakes, purpose and meaning, stretching, conversations, believing in the person, caring for the person, seeing the potential in the person, lesson sharing, being critical but in a positive way, being loved, being given autonomy, and taking risks.
Great. Thank you very much. Let's give our recorder a hand. The reason we did this exercise is because as you look to this succession development effort over the next few years, what you want to do is create, on a daily basis, powerful development experiences for yourself, because we need all of you to develop, and for your direct reports and the people who work with you. And we therefore have to understand what makes a powerful development experience. And you've identified the key elements. By the way, the other one is resources, and particularly time. You've got to provide time for the person to engage in some kind of stretching, challenging situation. Resources and time. Now, notice, was there any formal education involved here? Formal classroom training, seminar, workshop? No. Yet, what do we do when we want to develop somebody? We send them to a workshop. Oh my God. Now, I want you to continue to send people to workshops because that's how I make my living now. So continue to do that, please, Janice. However, powerful development and learning does not happen in a classroom setting. Classroom setting, what we're doing right now, creates a conceptual framework or a theoretical framework for new behavior, but it doesn't change your behavior. Only if you take some of the notions that you've written down here and you try to apply them will you be successful. This does not change behavior, what we're doing right now. All of these powerful development experiences, which you want to create these opportunities for powerful development experiences, have to incorporate these key ingredients. Note the key ingredients. And when you look back and evaluate your efforts, have we created the menu of powerful development experiences that feature these key ingredients? If you do, you will be very, very successful. If you send people to workshops and seminars and post classes and whatever else we do around here, you will not be successful. Okay, I'm going to give you in 5 minutes what a whole day would normally require, and this is what the research teaches us about accelerating development. There are three key findings from the research about what accelerates development. Again, that's our whole task. How do we accelerate the development of people? The first one is focus on learning by doing. There are two elements for successful development. Placing people in stretching job assignments, learning by doing, coupled with helpful and candid coaching, mentoring, feedback. Two things, stretching, coaching. Stretching, feedback. Those are the two elements. Not classroom training or education. So, if you want to develop yourself, which I hope you do, and if you see your role as growing more leaders, you will put them in situations where they're in stretching job assignments coupled with helpful and candid feedback and coaching. That's number one. Number two, understand the 70-20-10 rule. The ideal mix of development and learning for you as well as subordinates is the 70-20-10. 70% of all development and learning should be learning by doing. 70%, not workshops. 70%. 20% should be coaching. And we're going to be doing some work on coaching here in this organization. And then 10% should be classroom training, classroom education, formal education training. 70-20-10. Evaluate your learning, your development. Does it meet more or less the 70-20-10 rule? Number three, seek the sweet spot of development. The research says that there's a sweet spot of development, and that sweet spot is when you or your subordinate, who you give a task to, has a 50 to 70% chance of success. So if I give you an assignment, you're a high potential aspiring leader, and I give you an assignment where there's a 90% chance of success, why is that not the sweet spot? It's too easy. What I've just done is giving you more work for your full plate. Thank you very much. You're not doing anybody any favor. Why don't you want to give somebody an assignment where there's a 40% chance of success? It's too difficult. They're going to withdraw. They're going to feel overwhelmed. It won't be pretty. They will not embrace it. So the sweet spot is where people, yourself and others, have a 50 to 70% chance of success. Those are the three key learnings if you want to accelerate your own development or the development of others. So, as you look at the development opportunities you give people, does it match up with these key research findings? Any questions about that?
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
That 90% when you make an assignment, should you just do it yourself?
Well, you can give it to somebody. If they're smart, what they do is say, I understand we have to do this. I understand you want me to do it. But my next assignment has to be in the sweet spot. Mm-hmm. So we can give it. Just don't pretend you're developing the people. You're giving them more work. So let's be conscious of that. And then you say, okay, I'm giving you more work, but the next assignment, let's talk about, let's make sure it's in your sweet spot. That's how I would deal with it.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions? Okay. Okay, I'm going to share with you, and then we're going to go into some small groups. In a little while we're going to small groups. The typical four-pronged strategy for succession development. Now, you don't do all of this at once. So I'm going to give you, over time, what is the four-pronged strategy that is classic in terms of succession development. Over time, you will develop all four prongs. You're going to start someplace. It doesn't matter where you start. And if what I understand of where you're starting where most organizations start, which is the first prong, which is accelerating the development of talent already in the pipeline. So there's many ways of doing this. One of the great things about this retirement wave is we have a lot of vacant positions, acting positions. Acting positions are a terrific way to stretch people. Use your vacancies, use these acting positions, the interim management positions, to accelerate the development of people. This is probably one of the best ways of really stretching people. Put them into acting positions. Special projects, obviously, is another way. Training, if you have to have coaching, which is, again, you got the stretching job assignments coupled with coaching. You need coaching. So training all the managers on how to have a development conversation. It's sort of foundational. How to be a coach. Now, I want to differentiate between performance coaching, which is different from development coaching. So one of the things I would recommend is you look at how to have, train people on how to have a development conversation. Not difficult, but you need to do a little training. The Management Talent Exchange Program. In Santa Clara County and San Mateo County, we have a regional a group sponsored by the City Manager Associations. I'd like to invite Santa Cruz to participate in our regional effort. And one of the programs is the Management Talent Exchange Program. Once every 2 years, we take people for 3 months, September through December. We put them in another agency,
wow,
in a different discipline. So if you're a police officer, you would go to HR. If you're in HR, you would go to Public Works. If you're in finance, you'd go to the city manager's office. So you have 3 months where you're in a different culture, you're learning new skills completely outside your discipline. You get a coach, and there's a series of learning forums as well. You come back from that MTEP experience, we call it MTEP, supercharged. The next go-around is next year, 2017, September through December. If you'd like to participate, let me know. A lot of organizations have their own leadership academy, or they have a regional leadership academy that focuses on soft skills, not hard skills. And then we're going to be talking a little later about the ICMA coaching program, which is available to your organization. We're going to be incorporating in the coaching program into our succession development effort, and it includes webinars and one-to-one coaching and career compass columns and a whole bunch of other stuff, and I'll talk about that a little later. The second is this issue of capturing and transferring knowledge. And there's two kinds of knowledge, and there was mention of this earlier. Explicit knowledge is a kind of knowledge you can write down. So therefore, making sure there's desk manuals, procedural manuals. In Palo Alto, we created what was called a transition planning format. So if you were retiring, and before you got your last check, we insisted that you fill out this format. What were the key dates in the year? Where were the files kept? Online or in some cubbyhole? What were some training opportunities? Who could you match up with to get some help? So that was explicit knowledge, okay? Tacit knowledge is knowledge in your gut. It's very hard to write down. So we did some other things. The first thing we did, we created a Wikipedia. In Palo Alto, of course, we just don't call things generically. We call it a Palopedia. Palopedia, and where everybody can contribute to different topics. And we could collectively put our knowledge together. We also did something that was very interesting. If you were leaving the organization, we sent a team to interview you, which we videotaped, asking hard-hitting questions. You know, when did you fail? What did you learn from that? Who are the key players outside the organization that influences decisions? A bunch of, what did you learn? What were the big mistakes? How do you maneuver and navigate in certain politically charged environments? And we videotape these interviews, and then we put them on the shared drive. So anybody interested in this area, let's say environmental services, could come in and see the video. And then a lot of organizations create expert yellow pages. So they identify key people with key knowledge or skills or aptitudes throughout the organization. Anybody can go onto the online yellow pages and find the expertise. So how do we capture and transfer knowledge? The third area, there we go, is to re-recruit and retain talent, including early, mid, and late career talent. So certainly learning and stretching. All the data suggests that if you want talent to stay with you, if you want to create some organizational stickiness, learning is the new social glue. People will stay with you as long as they're learning and growing. This is especially true of millennials. As long as people, that's why job descriptions are so outmoded. You need to put people in situations where they're learning and growing. They will stay with you as long as they're learning and growing. When they stop learning and growing, there's a tendency to leave. So learning and stretch opportunities, stay in this. Now it's very interesting, when we are trying to attract talent, star talent, we lavish attention. Let's say we have a new planning manager we're trying to steal from somebody. Oh, we'll meet with them, we'll take them to lunch, we introduce them to people, all this stuff. As soon as we hire them, we forget about them, right? And then we don't talk to them again until it's an exit interview, right? Well, there's something called stay interviews. Anybody ever done a stay interview? Oh, this is great stuff. I did this in Palo Alto, and we had our managers do it. This is state interviews. You get together with somebody, and you ask them a series of questions, because you want to retain your talent. You have to retain your talent. So, what do you like most about your work? What keeps you here? What would entice you away? What do you want to learn this year? What strengths or talents do you have that we are not using? What part of working here strikes you as ridiculous? What conditions would cause you to seek employment elsewhere? If you could wave a magic wand, what changes would you make in the work environment? What can we do to ensure you, to ensure that we keep you with us? So when I was a city manager, I made a commitment, and our department has made a commitment, to have stay interviews with all our high potential talent that we wanted to keep. And we tried to spread this down to the whole organization. And I have a colleague who does this on the person's anniversary date. They do a walk-in stay interview, which also coincides with our wellness program. So anyway, stay interviews. If you're interested in this, I can send this to you. And then employee engagement efforts. Again, the research suggests that to the extent that people are engaged and energized, not satisfied, engaged and energized, they're likely to stay. To the extent that they're not engaged, first of all, they're very unproductive, and they're likely to leave. And then finally, the fourth is to attract talent, especially young talent, into the pipeline. And one of the things we have to do is to rebrand ourselves. As I mentioned earlier, we are not telling our story. We have the opportunity in our organization, we do this. We're trying to save the planet, we're trying to keep families safe, we're trying to address homelessness, we're trying our best to create economic vitality, to build affordable housing. We got a great story to tell, we're not telling it. So in the Silicon Valley, our two county next gen committee, we've begun to use a new brand with a logo, Local Government Careers, Making a Difference in Your Own Backyard. If you want to make a difference in your own backyard, join us. So how do we rebrand who we are? And by the way, our job announcements, you read one of these job announcements, oh my God, how boring can you get? Certainly job shadowing, internships. How many people started as an intern someplace? Internships are a very powerful way to hook young talent in our organizations. We have the regional internship program sponsored by our two counties. We'd love to have you guys involved as well. During the summer, all the agencies post their summer internship positions on one job board. And so young talent from the university, all they have to do is go to one job board, and they're eligible for up to 200 internships in local governments throughout the two counties. Apprenticeships, particularly trying to deal with technical positions, which we're losing that technical expertise, and then management fellowships for those who graduate with a master's, and we want to grab them before they go find career opportunities elsewhere. So those are the four prongs. Typically, you start with accelerating talent already in the pipeline, but eventually, over time, you should grow the program to incorporate all four prongs. Any questions? That's your classic four-prong strategy. Okay, now, before we go into our table discussions, Janice is going to describe some of the programs we're going to be offering, and we're going to then have a discussion about those at our table. So I'm going to turn it over to Janice.
Thanks, Frank. So listening to this presentation, I basically got my job written out of the budget by Frank, who says that we don't really need classroom learning as much as we think we do. So I want to start out with basically saying that I was going to talk about a lot of the classroom learning that's available. Most of these programs you've probably already seen or heard about. But I realized that instead I really want to have you guys listen for a call to action in what I'm sharing. I think many of you were at the quarterly managers and supervisors meeting where I was talking about the importance of love and caring in the workplace, and that what people really want, like Frank was saying, is the opportunity to learn and grow. So if you're not learning, you're dying. If you're not growing, you're dying. And like Frank said, that's going to be a huge part of how we keep people here in the city. So given that classroom learning is almost obsolete in terms of its learning and experiential learning potential, I want to make sure that people don't now think that classroom learning is not valuable. And so I want to share some feedback from our training program, which is what you see up there. We've got the annual training calendar of classes, which we offer like 30 to 40 classes every year. And we also have the employee and leadership development program, which are courses that are more geared towards becoming a supervisor or manager. So every single classroom learning opportunity I provide in the class, the most frequently asked question to me is, why are we the only ones here? Where are our supervisors and managers, right? So the training classroom learning is a huge opportunity for you to show two things, to show that you care about your employees' development and that you support them in that and that you provide the opportunities for them and say, hey, you know, you could take these classroom sessions to learn different skills, communication, professional development. That act of showing the employee that you actually care to tell them about it is already huge. And then the second piece is that by you coming to the class, I know you're all busy and you have the image of what a manager is all frenzied and running from meeting to meeting and doesn't have time to go to training, but the message that the employees are getting is that you don't care, that you don't want to be there, that you don't care about developing yourself and learning and growing and who you can be for them, right? They get the message that, oh, my manager's either too busy or doesn't care, or they think they're done, that they don't need to grow and develop anymore. And so we've had opportunities for where people do show up. It's really nice. Sometimes we'll have, like we had Ken Baer, who's a supervisor, and Adam Mink from the bargaining division who were in a class together. And some people are concerned about that. They think, oh, that's going to be really awkward. You know, you're in this classroom with your supervisor, you're not going to want to say anything. Or maybe the supervisors and managers don't show up because they don't want to make their employees feel awkward. But that actually is really not the case. When you come to the class together, it's your opportunity to listen and to hear what your employees care about. What are their issues that they're dealing with in the workplace? Where do they want to go? What matters to them? And there, it's an informal way for you to get that input and to hear them and to listen for that rather than just talking to them when you're doing their performance appraisal every year. So I don't want to dismiss the value of classroom learning. I think it's a tremendous opportunity. It's just the vehicle. It doesn't really matter what they're learning in the class. It's your opportunity to go there and be with your employees, hear what they have to say, participate, show that you care about who you are showing up in the workplace as. And then you get that opportunity to build communication and build trust. And that's a huge piece of all of this, is that, like Frank said, what keeps me up at night is how are we going to keep Claire and Amanda and Rebecca and Trey and Nico and Diana, right? We have so few of these young, talented people coming into our organization. It's hard enough to attract them, let alone retain them. So if the millennial generation is really concerned for their training and their development, and the most important factor in employee engagement is knowing that your supervisor cares about you. I shared that at the quarterly managers and supervisors meeting, and I truly believe that that is what keeps people here. It's not about how much pay they're getting, how many benefits. It's about, do I have opportunities to learn and grow? Does my supervisor care about me? So I think that's really what, I only have one slide here, so that's really what I want to convey. I mean, you can always ask me more details about the specifics of these programs, but just remind yourself what they are, what's already available. We have the mentoring program going. It's 6 months out of the year, and we'll offer it every year. And right now, we only have six pairs, and they're all great people, but why do we only have six pairs? Right? We've got, Claire and Tina Scholl, and it's like, what a great opportunity for Claire, who's already a powerhouse, to learn and grow even more, right? And from the best, Tina Scholl, right? You can't get better than that, right? So that's a tremendous opportunity for both of them to learn and grow. And then, for example, Rachel Kaufman, I think she's here, I saw her earlier, she actually invited me down to her staff meeting, which includes a lot of temps as well, and I presented our menu of training opportunities that are available. Because even though I send you all hundreds of emails all the time and everyone's gotten them and you think everybody knows about the training program, I have people come up to me and say they didn't even know they were allowed to take training, especially field workers. So that's kind of sad that they don't have these opportunities to go to the training and build these relationships with their colleagues, and that's what keeps people here. So I think that's really important to just say, hey, you know, these programs are available to you. I support you in participating in them. I'm going to be there too, getting the training with you. I also could use some help with my communication skills or time management, whatever it is. And then we also have job shadowing, which I don't think people really know about that. That's an ongoing program. People can say at any time that they want to shadow somebody. It can be somebody who they just want to tap their brain because they admire them and they want to know how did they get to where they got to in their career path. Or it could be somebody who, I had one worker who was like, I'm really interested in IT, and I'm also interested in working for Public Works and refuse collection. Like, they just wanted to see what's available out there. And those opportunities are what keep people here, because they're going, well, I don't have to leave if I want to change career paths, as I did. You know, I changed from planning to training to pursue something I was passionate about. So to tell your employee, hey, you're not necessarily stuck in the career path you're in. You have an opportunity to showcase your skills, and I'll work with you and coach you and help you to move to a better fit for yourself. So then the career path counseling, that's also something we offer that people might not know about. Lori Fukuda is our recruitment manager extraordinaire, and she knows the career ladders and all the qualifications for positions inside and out. So people can just come in and meet with her and say, you know, what else am I qualified for based on my resume and my background? And then for me personally, I offer more about, like, what are your strengths? You know, what are your work style preferences? What kind of job would be best for you? And I can work with people looking at their personalities and their strengths and weaknesses and really get at what are their needs in a job? How can they be fulfilled? And how can that we make that work in the city context? So I'm not going to go into all of the ins and outs of the programs, but really that's what I wanted to say about, you know, don't throw at the classroom learning. And encourage your employees as much as you can to participate in these opportunities, because really that's what's going to keep them here. So thank you, and I'll be coming back later for one more slide.
Okay, let's get back. I want to underscore a few things. First of all, you know, I'm Lebanese, so I exaggerate, okay? Janice made a good point. It's not an or. It's not classroom training or learning by doing. It's an and. Classroom training and learning by doing. So the most powerful is classroom training and then applying it with the support and feedback of the manager. So it's an and. The second point you made is role modeling. Boy, I'll tell you right now, if supervisors and managers, if their primary interest and focus is on pushing out the work and they don't role model, modeling is the most powerful way to lead. If you're not going to the training workshops, if you're not learning, if you're not making mistakes and learning from your mistakes, you've sent a powerful message that it's not important and it's not something we're committed to. And then again, the third point, the key point she made, all the research, particularly the Gallup research, says that opportunities to learn and grow and somebody cares about me are the two most powerful factors in terms of employee engagement and retention. So I just wanted to underscore those three big points. Okay, now, we're gonna get into your critique. So around here are the instructions. We're gonna spend about 10 minutes or so of discussion, and then I'm gonna ask you to pick out the top two ideas from each of the two questions. So at your table, there's a pad of paper, some pens. Somebody is the recorder. I'm gonna ask you to, at your tables, to identify what is missing. You saw the slide about what we're doing, the job shadowing, the mentoring, the this and that. What's missing? Not that we're gonna turn that around tomorrow, but as we grow the program, what's missing? What do we need to focus on? And then number two, if we are to effectively grow our own leaders and other successes, what are factors for success? What has to be true going forward if we're going to be successful in growing our own leaders? What are some factors for success that absolutely have to be present in the organization if we're to be successful? So, is it money for training? Is it role modeling? What has to be true? Okay, so let me summarize. At your table, you're going to spend about 10 or so minutes talking about these two questions. I'll give you a timeout, then you're going to pick the top two ideas in terms of one, and the top two ideas, in terms of two, and then we're gonna share in the large group. Any questions about what we're doing? You're gonna do this around the table, somebody's the recorder, and then we're gonna pick our top ideas. Let's do it. Spend a couple of minutes picking your top two ideas for each of the two questions.
Soft skills, and then
I would say,
grow our program over time. What do we need to incorporate? What is missing? So we want to focus on your top two ideas in terms of this first question. What's missing? Who has something that is missing that you identified? Yes. Development happening on top of current workload. Now, the issue there, and this takes some creativity, it's not an add-on. How do we incorporate development into our daily work? That's the challenge. Now, there's some ways of doing it, but you gotta really do some thinking, because adding doesn't work. I mean, we got full plates. So you've identified a key issue. It's possible. Okay, who has another thing that's missing or something we should be aware of? Yes.
Overall total organization commitment to that
school. Okay, we're gonna talk about that. Total organization commitment. This cannot be a little smattering here, a little smattering there, that won't work. You got a bigger challenge. Okay, that's a good one. What's missing? Or something else we should be aware of? Yes. Right. Okay. Right. So you need to be proactive, strategic. What's the big plan here? Instead of this reactive shotgun kind of effort. Okay, very good. What else? What's missing? Yes?
We talked about capture and retention of our assets, our internal assets.
Yes. Okay. And what? Give us a couple of examples of assets.
Institutional knowledge, organizational knowledge.
Okay. So capturing and transferring, not just capturing, but you've got to transfer, right? These assets, particularly knowledge assets, because we're in a knowledge business. Okay, very good. What else do we want to be conscious of? Yes?
There's the cultural value attached to, from the interview process on, to soft skills as well as technical.
Yes, so this is an and again. So yes, technical skills and the soft skills. Okay, very important. Yes?
We came up with competitive salaries for retention.
Okay, competitive salaries for retention. Okay. Yeah, the only way to really get a bump in your salary is go someplace else, right? Okay. Who has something else? Yes. I'm sorry, how do we do all this stuff and respond to the demands of the community? Okay, there's one here. Yeah.
Do you like what you talked about the mentor program?
Okay, so these intense learning experiences, whether they're inside or outside. By the way, you can do an MTEP experience inside your organization. Some of the agencies I work with have this internal management exchange program, management account exchange program. So intense learning, not just, you know. Okay, let's take one more, yes?
Talk about the value of being more interactive with other agencies.
Yes, right. You don't have to do it all yourself. In fact, if you're smart, you'll do it with other agencies. Now, you have a little disadvantage in that you're the big player and there's nobody else around you. However, there are some opportunities, depending on what they are, to collaborate with other agencies. And we have found in the Silicon Valley, where there's a lot of agencies that have capacity, developing a shared development program makes a lot of sense. Okay, let's go to the factors. Now, some of this stuff are factors for success, but what did you identify are, what has to be true going forward if we're going to be successful? Yes.
You have to recognize that you can get hit by a beer truck at any moment.
Yes, yes. A beer truck at any moment. I would like to think it'd be a scotch truck, but yeah.
Beer taco.
You can, yeah, nobody is indispensable. And just like that, life happens, right? So whether you're hit by a beer truck or there's some life-changing, you know, nothing certain. Okay, and you better prepare for that, okay? And we do this in our police and fire departments. We do this where we're thinking about, we have to plan for this unforeseen stuff. Okay.
We're waiting for the beer truck.
Yeah, we're planning for that beer truck. Wow. I'm sorry? Yes. We grew up in local government thinking that we operated in a stable environment. Man, those days are gone. So we have to get a lot more comfortable with this uncertainty. Okay, and basically create the capacities, the adaptive capacities, so we can respond. But we don't develop those adaptive capacities. We look at these very finite technical skills. Okay, what else? Yes.
The ability to facilitate and initiate conversations about goals and
yes, yes. This issue of how to have conversations with our staff on an ongoing basis as managers. You know, what are your goals? What are your aspirations? What are your hopes and dreams? How can I support you? Where do you want to be when you grow up? You know, these development conversations are, in my mind, the foundation for talent development. Okay, very good. Yes, sir.
Trust in the process.
Yes, we have to have trust in the process and knowing that there'll be some false starts, there'll be some mistakes, but over time we're going to, working together, we'll be okay. Yeah, you got to trust in the process. And it's not the process of HR, it's our process. We're going to talk about that in a second. Yes.
So for all of this on the top, really do need an effective mentor. You need
yes.
Somebody to hand out virtually every job in this
industry. Right.
You're going to need someone to.
Right. This notion, we got six, Jan said this, six mentors, really? That's inadequate is an understatement. Yes.
I think I have something related to the trust, is impartiality. I think people tend to stare at.
Yes, you need to focus attention on high potential employees and, again, it's not one of these doors, and we need to offer opportunities. So some of the opportunities may be lower intensity, like a lunch and learn program or a webinar. But there's this tension you have to deal with. Okay, let's take one more. Success factor, yes. Yes.
Departmental assessment.
Okay.
Departments, not just for the tactical.
Right.
Hire, but just identifying the and assessing our employees.
Okay. So not just doing these department assessments, but also looking at the competencies we need, the kinds of employees we need to develop.
Taking that further.
Right. Digging deeper. Just showing the boxes is not sufficient. Okay. Let's keep going.
I think that we've talked about having the tools
yes.
to be able to do the job. And we're
right.
talking about IT and
right.
how we're getting so technology dependent.
Yes.
And really having those tools
okay.
to be successful.
Okay, so having the tools and knowing how to use them.
There you go.
Okay, very good. Okay, let's give Janice a hand. Okay, I'm going to share with you real quickly the 10 top lessons from succession development programs from local government across the U.S. so you don't make the same mistakes. Okay? You're way ahead of people because you're addressing this issue. I commend you. What are the key learnings from all these programs? Number one, you need to see talent development as a critical business necessity going forward. It's not a nice thing to do. It has been a nice thing to do. It's now a critical core business necessity going forward. Number two, This cannot be seen as an HR initiative. You got great HR people, they're doing a lot of the work. If this is seen as an HR department-driven issue, you will fail. This has to be embraced as a city manager, department head, executive team initiative that's critical to the future viability of your organization. If it is not, it will fail. Number three, engage a cross-section of employees who are willing to serve as champions in developing the plan, implementing the plan. And we're going to be talking about the follow-up in a second and how we want to engage employees. Nothing changes without champions. And this cannot, you need top leadership, so it's top-down, but you also need bottom-up. Again, it's an and, not an or. And we're going to talk about how to do that. Number four, make talent development a primary responsibility of managers. Now, there's two ways of doing that. Number one, you want to recognize and reward managers in this room who are role models, who are great talent developers. So in some organizations I work with on a quarterly basis, they recognize a manager who is a great talent developer, who is a role model for the rest of us. That's one way. The second way is we refine our performance evaluation criteria for managers, and so talent development activities are evaluated. So is the manager having development conversations with employees? Are they providing the time so their employees can go to training? Are they providing stretching job assignments? You have to evaluate and hold managers accountable, all of us accountable, for doing some of these traditional talent development activities. Otherwise, you will fail. Number five is what I alluded to. You gotta target efforts, but make talent development opportunities available to all. If you have a leadership academy, in-house leadership academy, focusing on soft skills, you have to target that for a certain small group every year. And you have to have other opportunities to grow and develop that maybe aren't so resource intense or time intense. Target efforts, but make opportunities available to all. Number six, provide an array of opportunities, including coaching. So coaching is key, and people are, you know, people love choices. You don't want to have just one or two programs. You want to have an array, and we do, an array of opportunities to develop yourself. Number seven is a critical one, is align all organizational systems. So, is if talent development, succession development, if it stands by itself, you will not be successful. You have to align it, all your organizational systems, to support talent development. Is talent development, for instance, part of our strategic plan? Is it one of the council priorities? Is it one of the city manager initiatives? Is it aligned with rewards? Is it aligned with training? Is it aligned with promotion? Is it aligned with performance management? For instance, if we're not evaluating our managers on talent development, it's not important. Have we aligned all our organizational systems to support succession development? Number eight, go beyond classroom training to provide job experience that stretches aspiring leaders. Number nine, place responsibility on the employee. Now, here's an important point. The organization has certain responsibilities. You have to make it a priority, which you have. You have to provide training and resources. You have to provide some education for managers, what we're doing right now. So the organization has, you got to train coaches. The organization has responsibility. Managers, all of you have responsibility. You have to take the time to talk and converse with employees about their development. You have to provide time for them to go get development or go to a class or do something. You have to provide stretching job assignments. You have to provide encouragement and support. You have to take the time to relate and connect. So you have a responsibility, but the ultimate responsibility lies with the employee. It's up to the employee to take action. It's not your responsibility to take action. It's the employee's ultimate responsibility. And if the employee doesn't want, for any number of reasons, to advance or try something new or stretch and grow, put your attention elsewhere. Everybody has a responsibility, but the ultimate responsibility is the employee. And number 10, which is absolutely essential, is allow mistakes. This is very difficult in our risk-averse environment. So, if we have a staff report to the council, who is better able to make the staff report? The department head or an aspiring leader? Usually, the department head who's had 30 years of experience giving staff reports. We don't need the department head to make the staff report. We need the emerging leader to make the staff report. Now, you have to prepare people for that. So we have to have a conversation with the city manager. Hey, I'm not going to give it to somebody else. We have to have a discussion with the council. Be prepared for some mistakes. They may not be able to answer all the questions you throw at them. But we need to put aspiring leaders in a position where they are now making presentations. So let's take another example. Who is better able to lead a project team? Frank, who has 30 years leading project teams, or a mid-manager or a management analyst who has never led a project team? We don't need Frank to lead the team. I know how to do that. Again, there will be mistakes. We need mistakes. Now, here's the deal you make with employees about mistakes. We have a professional safety net. If you're committed to excellence and you make a mistake, you have a net. We will protect you. If you make a mistake but you don't care and you continue to make the mistake, you don't have any professional safety net. If you're committed to excellence, you have a professional safety net. Otherwise, no mistakes, no learning, no development. Questions about the 10 lessons learned? Yes, sir.
What is that safety net you're talking about?
Well, let me give you an example. In Brea, where I used to work, one of our values, now typically when you have values on the wall, they don't mean anything, right? One of them was we provide a professional safety net. So if a council person or if a community person tries to go after somebody who made a mistake, either if they made a mistake or people think they made a mistake, or typically it was a disagreement, not a mistake, but they have to go through me and they have to go through the department. We are not going to let anybody, and we're very conscious of this, nobody attacks a staff person. We can disagree, we have policy disagreements. You are not going to, we take a timeout, we take a recess, we stand up, we point it out, nobody does that. Now, your behavior every day tells people whether you're going to protect employees or not. But they have to be committed to that, to excellence. If they're committed to excellence, you can make mistakes. Because that's how we learn. If you think you can learn from successes, you're wrong. Think about the bike. So it's very important. Are we going to allow mistakes? And how do we make adjustments to make sure that we protect people? Okay. Let me quickly share some resources with you. We're going to send out an electronic flyer about the coaching program. The ICMA coaching program is sponsored by the International City County Management Association. It's the association that Martine and I belong to. It offers 6 webinars. The upcoming one is on successful supervision and leadership on September 8th. Typically, the organization invites people to come to a room, and sometimes there's a department head who hosts the webinar. We provide questions for a post-webinar discussion. It's on key topics like storytelling or knowledge transfer on November 17th. We're going to do one on November on knowledge transfer. They're free. Wow. All you got to do is show up. Somebody has to register and show up, and we have a webinar, and we're doing learning, and it doesn't cost us anything. We also have one-to-one coaching. If you go on the Cal ICMA website, you can go to the coaches gallery, and there are 100 senior leaders, including myself, who have already agreed to be your coach. Anybody in this room could go on the website, pick a coach, send us an email, we've already agreed to be your coach. What a deal. It's free, it's easy, it's simple. It can be a one-time, periodic, or ongoing conversation. And we've agreed to be your coach. We also have speed coaching. It's like speed dating, only more effective. and we're hosting that in the Silicon Valley in March, but we can also offer one in your county as well. Women leading government. Anybody went to the Women's Leadership Summit? Okay, it's co-sponsored by MMANC and Women Leading Government. They provide networking and educational sessions. And also I write a career compass advice column. It's like Dear Abby, only it's Dear Frank. And that is also, it's on career and leadership topics. If you want to receive the career compass, just give me your business card or write your name legibly and your email address on the back of my card, which is up here. And I'll put you on the email distribution list. Some other resources, we're gonna send out an article called Retaining and Growing Talent, Strategies to Create Organizational Stickiness. I also wrote a report for ICMA on creating a talent strategy. If you're interested in that, let me know, I'll send it to you. And then, in addition to your professional associations in public works and wastewater and police and fire, I would highly recommend for you, as well as your staff, they get involved in a general leadership, general management association in local government. The two are for mid-level people, the Municipal Management Association of Northern California, and the other one is the International City County Management Association. And there are the two emails and the two websites. It's important for us, again, general leadership, general management, to go beyond our technical disciplines. Okay, what's next? What the hell is next?
Thanks, Frank. So we'll just go really quickly through this. The first thing that we have coming up next is for HR is gonna work one by one with each department to do, we're gonna bring you those org charts that are color-coded and we're gonna talk to you about your specific vulnerabilities, positions that are difficult to fill, you know, senior managers that you may be expecting to retire. We're gonna work with each department to come up with a specific plan. And then the next one is a really big one. The performance appraisal forms haven't been updated for over 15 years. And so obviously they're not current in terms of, you know, they're really focused on technical skills and job knowledge. There are no definitions of what those things are. And they don't really focus on the kinds of competencies that Frank has been talking about through today as being really important for succession planning. So how many people liked a performance evaluation?
I hate them.
Well, I think it's one of the most dreaded tasks for most managers and supervisors. So we're really hoping to change that by streamlining the forms and providing guidelines. And we're going to provide some training on how to actually use them to gain value for yourself and for your employees. So learning how to have those development conversations and how to create that ongoing coaching throughout the year. And they now include an optional self-appraisal form that has some questions to facilitate that conversation for, you know, your employees to say how do they want to grow and develop, what new skills do they want to learn, and how can you best support them as a supervisor. So just a note for you that we will be now evaluating supervisors and managers on how well they're doing in terms of developing their teams and talent. So that's a new kind of challenge that we can all rise to. And then Frank already talked about the ICMA coaching program. We have the first one scheduled for September 8th. I booked the library meeting room so we can all watch together the webinar. And that should be a really exciting topic. It's successful supervision and leadership. And then number four here is we are going to be piggybacking some of these succession development initiatives onto the organizational health committee because we already have this committee which has good representation from different departments. And so we're going to take all the data that we gathered here today, all of your input, and we can kind of go through it methodically and look at a plan for action. What can we prioritize? What can we do right away? And what's going to take longer and involve more people? And our plan is to use focus groups as a way of of getting input on specific ideas. So first, we're going to kind of call through the data, and then we're going to ask you to send, you know, interested people or you yourself to participate on focus groups to look at specific initiatives that we can implement. And then lastly, we're going to be sending you out a homework assignment. And I just have this sheet of questions here that it's going to be something that you can take back to your staff to get input from them directly on, you know, some of the ideas that we talked about here, and then giving them an opportunity to give their ideas for developmental opportunities and training, things that they'd like to see at the city. So one of the questions is, who's interested in participating on a focus group for succession planning and development? So we will be sending out that follow-up email with the articles that Frank talked about, and we're gonna send out the PowerPoint, and we're also gonna send out this assignment. It's just a one sheet for you to bring back to your staff meeting and you to facilitate that conversation, get the input, and then return it back to me in HR. So don't forget to look for that assignment. It's very important, that step of getting the staff input. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Okay, we're gonna now have some reactions to today's material. First of all, we're gonna have Dave from the police department. Who's it?
Police department.
I mean, fire department, I'm sorry. Fire, police, what's it again? It's all public safety. Now, wait a second, let's all wish Dave happy birthday. Today's his birthday. Talk about the silver tsunami. What resonated with you from today's material, Dave?
Well, I'm on the boomer end of things, so I'm on the bad side of the scale, which is a good place to be.
Yeah, very good.
But I think the one thing that I thought was, resonated with me in this time we spent together was the difference between the model of a leader versus a manager. When I came into the fire department, I had a very good opportunity to come into a division that had two leaders and mentors, I'll say, that they both retired now, that did just that. They provided the mentorship and opportunity and development, which in turn allowed me to develop a very high level of respect and trust for them, and which led to also a very strong motivation for me to want to be successful and to learn, and they provided a platform that I needed to.
What a lucky guy.
So now I'm in their position, and I'm able to use those same skill sets and pass those on to the people below me. And so I think that's critical.
Anything that did not resonate with you today?
No, I think all of the information had some good aspect to it, so I don't really have any negative components. Okay.
Anything you'd like to add?
No.
Okay, happy birthday. Bonnie from Economic Development. Bonnie, can you stand? What resonated with you today from today's period?
Well, the hug.
Yeah.
Let me stand over here.
So. Okay, why don't you stand right here?
My back.
Right by me.
Yeah.
There you go.
So the hug resonated with me, first off. And I think because I wasn't sure you were really going to hug. And I think. But what about it that resonated was the vulnerability. And so the reminder, as we're going through this, a lot of, you know, as we're talking about the retention, right, and the development, yeah, and succession planning, is about being vulnerable,
right,
and sort of sharing, and that sort of sharing and caring and having those conversations. And in that moment, you know, as we're talking about some of these challenges, that some of them we can't address right now, the housing, the,
right,
cost of living, and,
right,
you know, we have so many of those things that we work on day to day, but we can't address them day to day. But one of the things that we can do more of is caring. and having those conversations and those communications of how are you doing today, and you know, what a hell of that project, that was really hard, and just showing in the workplace every day that you care, and having that reminder of oh how important that is and how much that resonates. So to me that was powerful. So I really enjoyed that. I think also the importance of the learning and growing opportunities really resonated a lot with me. Sort of that reminder of oh there's so many opportunities, and just personally I realize I don't take advantage of those opportunities every time. So that reminder of that and trying to incorporate that in the day-to-day working and making sure that we're providing those within our department and across the city. So that resonated a lot.
Anything that did not resonate with you today?
I think it's one of the challenges of some of the opportunities of being able to exchange across agencies. I mean, you address that challenge too. I think for us, because we are landlocked, I think we resonate a lot with Over the Hill. It's really hard to get there. We were joking at our table about sort of the job swap goes with the, you know, wife or husband swap and the children swap, and then we all sort of, you know,
I've got a wife swap, I don't want to do that again.
So I mean, that's a challenge, because I think we all were intrigued by that, but that's hard. And then I think, what do I have to add? I don't have anything necessarily to add, but I think I'm really encouraged by some of the things that Janice was saying about coming up with a specific plan by department and really looking at you know, those and being able to have those stay conversations. And also, you know, what will it take for you to stay here and grow, and then working that into our day-to-day.
By the way, I'll send Janice the list of those stay interview questions, and we'll share those with everybody. Okay, Dan from Whistler. Where's Dan? I saw Dan. Okay, yeah, don't hide. Can you stand down? What resonated with you today?
Two things. One was the individual conversations, both formal and informal,
Okay.
That crosses over to learn a lot of things, an informal conversation, and not just them coming to the office, but being available outside and making that a part of your daily activity. And then the other thing was the say interviews and with a commitment and an action. I can't read without an action plan, and not a state interview in the essence of preparing to replace that person, but preparing to retain that person.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Very good. And finally, we're going to end with Claire, Fish the Fleece Slaughter. Claire, can I get that close? Okay. Cool. Now I was practicing at the break time about how the hell to pronounce your name. What resonated with you?
So four things. I'm a millennial, I think that's why I was asked.
Really?
Yeah, really. One of seven in here, I think, is what I counted. So I had four things. The first was opportunities to learn and grow. That's why I chose to switch jobs and come here. The opportunity to have challenges and opportunities. The knowledge that there is a path to move forward and that this is a place that you can stay. And fourth, that your supervisor cares. I'm kind of in a weird position. I work in two departments. Ron left, so I can't embarrass him, but Ron and Jim are my two supervisors, and they're both really great about being very direct and having conversations about how we're doing, what's going on, what I want to grow in, what's challenging. So those were the four things that resonated with me.
Anything that did not resonate with you?
Nope.
Okay. Gosh. Okay, thank you very much. Let's give our four reactors. Okay, the last thing I want you to do is I want you to take out a pen and beginning tomorrow, what is one thing I will prioritize to promote talent development in my part of the organization? If there isn't one thing you commit to, then you've just wasted 3.5 hours with Frank. So, take out a pen. All I want is one thing. And you have to write it down, or it's not real if you don't write it down. Don't keep it in your head. What's one thing, one simple thing, that you're willing to do to commit to in terms of developing talent, yourself, as well as others? So let's write that down. With you. If you want to be put on the email distribution list for the Career Compass column, By the way, I'm going to send you one as a follow-up on storytelling. Just give me your email address, give me your card or email address and name. Remember the coaching program, free webinars, free coaching, everybody get a coach, everybody go to the webinars. They're terrific ways without this organization spending any money. It's been a joy. Thank you very much.
Really great to have somebody like Frank who has clearly a passion and a lot of experience in this field, and also someone who has had experience working in a city that's pretty much like ours, full service complex. So I think he has a lot of really direct experiences and connections that would be able to assist us. The one thing we do have difference, I haven't done a wife swap, so. But so thank you very much. I found it really, really great, and I think this will help us moving forward. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And the other thing I just wanted to mention is that I just wanted to let you know that I am very much committed to continuing this and moving this forward. Leadership development and talent development obviously is very critical to our organization. And I'm very committed to it, so is the whole department head team. We've actually been spending a lot of time on this over the last year plus. So there's a commitment there at the top of the leadership. Also, if you all don't know, this is a strategic goal that the City Council has adopted. And so we wanted to make sure that we add there as one of our overall city strategic goals. So we have a commitment to do that. And that's why we've been putting the effort and the focus and having our HR department also spend a lot of time and attention to this and all the various aspects of organizational development and making our organization better. So there's a strong commitment to doing that. And also to call you to be part of it and to take it on, because all of us have to do it together. And that's really the way to do it. You're all stakeholders, as Frank mentioned, and so we need you all to be involved and to participate and to provide feedback. And I can see that that's there because there's so many of you here. And I think there's so many that actually wanted to come and couldn't come. And this is really a great thing to do. We ought to really do more of this. So I look forward to having more discussions and sessions with you on these important topics. So thank you very much for being here today. And I think that's it. So thanks very much to all of you. Appreciate it.